Hello, Tosha.
Hello, Lilo.
Nice to interview you again.
Very happy to be here.
Long time ago, I interviewed you many years ago on the divine, and I think this is your main topic, actually. Actually, this book, even though if it's called The Secret of Abundance, hein, Le Secret de l'Abondance in French, because your book just came out in France, it's related to the divine because you love flirting with the divine. You are a brilliant mind from Yale University, but you not got sidetracked, but you, how would you put it? You got interested about metaphysics and all these topics at quite a young age, and then you started to devote your life to it.
Exactly.
So I'm excited to speak about the abundance and how you view this abundance. What is for you, first of all, the definition of abundance?
One of the reasons I wrote the book is because it never made sense to me that abundance was something outside that you went to chase. And so if only I had three houses, I would be abundant. Or if only I made this amount of money a year, I would be abundant. I knew that wasn't it. So to me, it's an internal feeling. And there's a part of the book that really talks about being abundance as opposed to seeking it. And it's that sense that one way or another, your needs will be met. And also that the universe or love or whatever you want to call it can use you as a conduit for the good. And so you literally become abundance to be able to both give and receive, and not only this idea of chasing.
Yes. So it's so I hear it's more of a state of being, and it's a lot to do with faith in the end, no?
Yes, and in a funny way, with this idea of being used as a vehicle.
Yes.
You know, because I think sometimes when abundance is discussed, it's like, what can I get for myself, for me? But in fact, this act of being abundance, there's a line in the book, I think, that there's the Sufi poet Hafez, and he has a line where he says, be the one that everybody's luck changes when you walk in the room. And it's just an ancient Persian saying, and I think that's being abundance, that the techniques for how to hold that state, everybody starts having improvement just because you're holding that state. So it's not only for yourself.
Yeah. So in the end, when you write a book or you create a project, whatever it is, you're basically the hands, the foot, the mouth of God, or you do it for God, for the universe, or how do you frame it? Because this is very different than what we usually do.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes I think the word God gets complicated because it gets so mixed up with religion and everything. So I use God in the book as a word, but equally it could be love. So, or the divine or the universe, as you say. And so I would say it's a sense of let me be a conduit for the good. Use me, let it come through me. And you know, this is even, I'm really pragmatic, I'm very practical. So even on a very specific level, like you have to make a phone call that you're dreading to make, and you keep putting it off, I don't want to call. So you can even do this where you say, use me to make this call, give me the words, take me over, give me the courage to do it because I keep putting it off. So it's a very specific invitation to this force of love to do the doing through you, as opposed to I have to, you know. It releases a lot of fear and stress and lets the conduit take over.
I see. Because you walk us through an 8 weeks process. So little by little, I mean, the prayers are very, are part of the prayers, the affirmations, the mantras are part of the process, right? As well as clearing up the house, as well as raising the vibrations. Can you tell us kind of like the general process to go from where we're at right now, maybe with fears and lack and a sense of victimization, to all the way to be flowing and a conduit for love?
Well, we laid out the book the way that it is because that way you don't have to pressure yourself that all of a sudden, oh my God, I have to clear out every negative thought in my mind, because this isn't about manifesting. This isn't about trying to be perfect so that you get every wish. This is a much more receptive, flowing way to allow. The book has a lot to do with learning to allow and learning to receive and learning to invite in this force of spirit.
Like more of a spiritual path, like more of a spiritual way of being in life.
Yeah. Exactly. That isn't just all of the shoulds and have to's and must and pushing and force and all of that. So there's a course of 8 weeks that were simply created just because there are these different steps that all contribute. But there are people that they write me and they just do the first week. You know, for right now, you can take this in bite size. So, you know, one of the weeks, for example, is about opening to receive, because there are people that simply say, I'm not a receiver. I only give. I give and I give and I'm exhausted and I'm angry, but I don't receive. And so that week is shifting that so that you're open to receive. Another week, as you say, is cleaning out your space, simply because when it's filled with everything you don't need, just like Marie Kondo said, she was right, it's very hard for what's needed to come in. And then on another level, another week is about some of the thoughts that we're taught to say because it's cultural or it's familial, like I don't deserve, or I'll always resent this particular person who hurt me. And so it takes you through the old resentments, the old blames, to help clear those. So it's a very practical process. But as I say, some people just do it one step at a time. They don't only stay 1 week on an idea. They stay 3 weeks on an idea until they're complete with it.
Mm. There seems to be a lot of universal laws and principles in this book.
Yeah, one of the ideas that's underneath the whole thing is this idea of divine source. And I love this idea because it says, I think maybe it was originally said by Florence Scovel Shinn, who was a writer back in the 1940s in the States. But it's this idea that no person, place, or thing is your source. That let's say you're needing a new job. Rather than saying, I have to go and apply for that job, and if I don't get that job, I'll be devastated. Rather than saying that, divine source would say, you make a prayer that says, the right job for me is already selected. The perfect connection for me is already selected, and I am open to all actions and invitations that need to happen. And then divine source lines you up. You know, it's the same way, because the book isn't only about money. It's the same way if you were looking for a relationship, rather than saying it has to be that person, you're saying the right person for me is already selected. And then you're following divine source as it shows you the actions and the steps.
So you would say money works in the same way than other things that we would like in our life?
Yeah, I think it's all very connected to learning how to move with the flow, how to release what's no longer needed, and how to invite what wants to come, what's meant to come.
There seems to be that we have big intentions and wishes and dreams, but the receiving, as you said earlier, somehow we auto-sabotage, we push away, or we don't allow it. Like it, there seems we're not confident and positive about how great life is, like, you know, like this vision of thinking that life is against us instead of with us in this process.
Well, I think I agree with you. And I also think there's two pieces of this, because the focus of the book, it's not a manifesting book. So it's not like saying, focus on all your wishes and then over and over and over, keep saying, I will get that, because it's working with divine source and with the flow. So I'll give you an example. Like, I'm moving soon. And so in my mind, I thought, oh, when I move, it would be good to buy something because I've always rented. But I offered it to the divine and I said, okay, let the perfect place is already selected. I'll be guided. My boyfriend and I will be guided together. The right place will come. What actually came after several months was a rental, but it was the perfect rental. So it wasn't what I had been looking for from the mind, but yeah, it was really what was right. So if somebody was saying, whatever I focus on, I'm meant to get, I would say, no, you're actually, if you align your energy with the right.
What's right for me.
What's right for me is meant to come. Then you actually open the flow. And so it often involves releasing the attachments to how you think it's supposed to go. And then on top of that, yes, it's about, part of the weeks are about keeping the mind positive, but also emotions need to come up. So it's not about bypassing emotions where if you're disappointed or whatever, those have to be felt too. But then they're offered back to the divine again to say, open me to receiving what wants to come.
Is there some things to heal about the divine when going through that process? Because we're all at different stages with that too.
You know, I think that's an interesting question, because there's a part of the book that's about the inner child. And I really think, depending on people's backgrounds, sometimes people feel, for example, like God has abandoned them, or they used to be, have a relationship to the divine when they were very young, and now they're bereft and alone. And what I found, I don't know, from teaching this all these years, is that it's often the inner child who is the one who feels bereft. And so there's a whole part of the book that's about going in, beginning to take care of this very young part that feels abandoned by God, but actually what it really is abandoned by is often ourselves. So if you go in, you start to take care of it, build a relationship on the inside. I'll often say to people in the beginning, don't worry about God. If you're still mad at God for this and that, forget it. It doesn't even matter. Just build a relationship to that kid and let it start to feel that it has an ally on the inside. Because if it starts to feel taken care of by you, and you have that inner adult saying, I'm with you, I'm caring for you, over time you start to realize that that compassionate adult on the inside is very similar to that inner divine voice.
It feels like we're including ourselves in the big picture. We're not separating ourselves anymore.
Exactly. It changes the whole paradigm from the divine is out there somewhere and it has abandoned you or hurt you. It moves it internally to that place of it's the inner voice of love. But for many people, contacting that inner voice of love involves the inner child who feels left behind.
It has a lot to do with trusting too, isn't it? That the right thing will arrive at the right time. Like distrusting it's like being in the unknown and stepping in the unknown and being okay with that.
Yes. And you know, one of the things, like, you can listen to a lot of spiritual talks and they'll always say, you should trust. And I'm so practical. I would think years ago, how? You're not telling me how to trust. Or they would say, you should surrender. Nobody said how. So to me, the how of all of these is the prayers really help, like where you're literally saying, give me faith, show me how to do this. I don't trust you. You've let me down so many times. Show me how to have faith. Even in the beginning, it can really be how to have faith in yourself, not this idea of a divine, which can get confusing, but just how to give me faith in myself, give me faith in the flow. And, you know, the other thing I think is that it's a muscle that gets developed so that, you know, the more you practice this stuff, you start to see little miracles happen and they build faith. You know, all of a sudden you're thinking about somebody and all of a sudden they call, or somebody gives you a lead and says, why don't you go to that place? And when you go to that place, something very unusual happens. You start to trust the flow, not because somebody tells you you should, but because you start to have the experience.
And you want to.
Yeah. You, the more it happens, the more you're like, wow, I think something's going on here. But it takes practice. It's like working out at a gym or something, right?
You refer to the check that Jim Carrey wrote to himself for $10 million. And a lot of people try that, the $1 million check, the $10 million. But you're saying it's not really what's needed to most people's soul's journey. Like, some of us will do it, and there's some, you know, people that teaches that to write this check, but it doesn't always work, and there's a good reason. I mean, how do you view that?
There's an idea in the book called Prarabdha Karma, and it's the idea that every soul has an individual curriculum that it's here to learn. And so, you know, one soul could be here to learn that simply they will always have enough. Not that they need to be a multimillionaire. The soul has nothing to learn from that for that person. Somebody else may need to become a multimillionaire, but for somebody else, that's not the karma. They're just having to trust that they will have enough. And so they could write $10 million checks until their head fell off and nothing would happen. I mean, I'll tell you the truth. I don't know if I've ever said this publicly. I wrote one of those checks. When I first heard about it, like 30 years ago, before I knew this work, absolutely nothing happened because I had so many things just to learn about, not telling the divine I need this amount and that amount, but to learn how to just move with the flow. So, and know that what was meant would occur. And not only would I have enough, but I would have enough to give back. So I think that's how it goes. Everybody has a different set of lessons.
When the flow is not there, what is your instant tool or prayer or what you recommend to do to kind of snap out? Because you know how it goes. We can little by little get into this negative vortex, whereas we want to get back in the flow as quickly as possible.
You know, what's interesting with that is now I never think that the flow is gone because I think that we just forget. So yes. It's almost like coming out of amnesia because the flow is the flow. It's everything, right? So it has nowhere it can go. So often for me, let's say the mind is in a spin. You know, it's always the mind, right? And the mind is going off on some crazy thing. I'll just do a prayer. Sometimes I'll do a prayer that says, save me from my mind. Quiet my mind, lift me out of this delusion, because it often is delusion. And or it's you're picking up negativity from other people, or you've read the news too long and you're forgetting that there's this central reality inside of yourself. So I do very simple prayers like that. Or sometimes I'll even say, restore me to sanity. You know, you're filled with resentment about somebody and you say, restore me to the sanity of knowing I will always have enough. Nobody else can take my good. There is no, you know, think about all the things we're taught that we're all in competition with each other to get this or to get that, and somebody else can take your good. But what divine source would be saying is when you're anchored inside to the true source of abundance and that you are abundance, nobody else can take your good. Even if there's temporary loss, it will always return another way because it's coming from your connection.
And from within too.
That's what I mean. From within and without, you're anchored in that flow. The flow never goes anywhere, but we can move in relationship to it. So you put yourself back in the center of that flow again.
Yeah. You know, in France, we complain a lot. lots of complaint. So how to, I guess this is not useful in this, for the secret to attract abundance or to be part of this abundance, right?
Well, no, I mean, look, I'm Jewish, so we grew up complaining all the time too. So it's this feeling of, again, we're not, this book is not about attracting abundance. This is not the secret. This is not, you have to keep your mind in some pristine, perfect place that you can never be negative. That's human. You know, no matter what country you're from, everybody has a bad day sometime, right? So it's not really about that. It's about knowing, first of all, when the mind is doing its complaining and negativity, where something greater than the mind. That's what the mind's doing. But then there's the anchoring in the great self, in that love. And that's the part that's witnessing the mind. That's the part that I want to say you're anchoring in the truth of who you really are. The mind has a good day. The mind has a bad day. It goes up and down. So it's partly that. And it's partly just knowing that thing that this isn't about attracting abundance. It's about being abundance. And that anybody, I'm not special, anybody can learn to do these things that are in the book. I write about in the book, it wasn't so much that I was a negative person as I was terrified of so many things. I had a lot of fear. And the act of doing this process made the mind start to quiet down enough that what wanted to happen could begin to happen without my getting in the way. And I think anybody can learn that.
It seems hard to be connected to that without the open heart. So let's say a person had a lot of difficult moments in life and little by little, the heart was closed. It seems difficult to experience abundance and the divine with a closed heart. Is that something that you talk about in the book?
Yeah, you know, I think it goes back again to the part of the book that's it's in there in several areas, but it's particularly in there about that child, the inner child, because, you know, the child has a good reason usually to have shut down. You know, it's not that the child's bad. It often just feels abandoned, hurt, resentful, whatever, for very good reason. And it's a process, you know, so I think this idea that in 8 weeks, you change dramatically. For some people, in 2 days, they change dramatically. And they write me these letters like, wow, I'm suddenly receiving. I'm for the first time in my life, I know how to receive. And it happened in 48 hours. But other people write me and they say, you know, I did the book for 6 months. It took some real focus because I had all these parts of me. I had a lot of people I had to forgive. I had to forgive myself. You know, it's a process of kindness towards the self. And then I think the heart comes along on its own. You know, it has its own timing.
Yeah. How does it work within a couple when the other is not really aligned with that? Can we practice that on our own? Or does it multiply really when both are doing it and it just like, whew, it's like the feminine and the masculine? Whew.
Yeah, that's a great question. I think it depends. It depends on the case. Like there's, you know, obviously it's great when two people come together and both do it. It's very, very powerful, but that doesn't always happen. And I get a lot of letters where somebody says, I'm doing it. My partner thinks this is the stupidest thing in the world and has no interest. And usually what I'll say to them is, just keep doing what you're doing. Don't even worry about them. Don't try to change them. Leave them alone and do your thing. And often what happens, not all the time, but more often than not, the partner starts to see these changes happening for the person. Even with this issue of cleaning out the space, there's so many letters I've gotten where one person wants to, the other person doesn't. So the person goes ahead, takes care of their end. And then all of a sudden, you know, somebody writes me and they say, all of a sudden, my partner just got rid of half of their things out of nowhere because they feel the incentive. They're watching the flow. Even somebody who's very shut down will often notice the flow of change, moving in the Shakti, the light coming in, and they'll be like, wow, how's that happening? I want to feel that too. So it's, you kind of, the worst way is to try to convert somebody. Like, that never works, as you know.
Do you speak, you use the term Shakti here.
Yes.
So when I hear Shakti, I hear the feminine, I hear orgasm, I hear sacred sexuality, I hear movement and the feminine. So how is that part of this conversation?
Well, to me, yes, the Shakti is the divine feminine. And I mean that not only in terms of women. To me, the divine feminine and the divine masculine, it's regardless of gender. It's in all the genders. Like, yes, it's there. And I do think that the general focus that we have in these Western cultures is on the masculine. Go get it, make it happen, push it, force it. You're bad if you can't get it. This is very different. This is if you, oh, the divine feminine, she's reawakening on the planet right now. I mean, this is what's happening. It's a long process, but she's coming out of this long period of being ignored and denigrated. And so, yes, to me, she's very present in this book, where learning how to receive, learning how to open, learning how to allow this force of spirit to come in, that's all part of that divine feminine. And it's actually been funny, some of the guys who have written me and have said, wow, for the first time, I actually can feel the other side of myself. So we're all both.
Yeah. And it has a lot to do with dancing with the flow too. Right?
Definitely.
I hear a lot of the movement and being flexible with whatever is happening.
Yes. Although that's really tricky too, because sometimes it gets misinterpreted as being passive, and it gets interpreted as always saying yes to everything. I know there was a book that came out a few years ago, and it was about surrender, and it was like, you just have to say yes to whatever occurs. I don't think that's what's true, personally. This is my opinion. Working with this is about letting the flow take over. And so that doesn't mean saying yes to everything. That can mean yes, saying yes. It can also mean something happens that's very wrong, and that flow comes in and says, you need to stand up and say no. I mean, there was a woman who wrote me a few months ago. She'd read the book. She was in a terrible marriage. She was being psychologically abused all the time. She said, I read the book. Does that mean I'm just supposed to say, wow, the divine brought this marriage, I should stay no matter what? I'm like, no, you take the marriage, you offer it to the divine, because the central foundation of the book is offering, that everything is handed over so that the right actions get shown. You offer it to the divine. You say, if you want me to stay here, give me the courage to stay here. But if you want me to get out, help me get the hell out. She wrote me a month later and she said, I'm out. It's like everything picked me up and gave me the courage to go. So it's dependent on the situation. The flow shows it.
Yeah. So we can give that relationship, give that problem or that specific situation, even related to money or not, to the divine.
Yes. And that's the power of it. It's so different than thinking the mind always has to be in a perfect state every moment. You'll have good days, you'll have bad days. But the offering is the central modality, because you're now releasing the burden. Oh, it's on my back. I have to find the right house. I have to find the right job. That gets released. And then you're in that place of, I really see it like with the hands, like you're giving it up. And then you're saying the right actions will be shown from the inside at the right time.
That reminds me a lot of the forgiving process, if that's the right word, but the offering. You know, when something, we feel negative energy or something is not going well, to trust that the divine will, in some ways, instead of ourselves, you know, acting and wanting to revenge or to not forgive, just knowing that this will be, the divine will find a solution.
Yes, and that you'll be shown the actions. You know, there's sometimes you offer something over and there's literally nothing for you to do. And the whole situation reorganizes itself around you because you've offered it. But there's other times you offer it and there's actions. You're shown the actions to take. So, yes.
It's important that you talk about actions indeed, because it's not just about meditating and sitting there, but it's feeling the inspiration and the creativity and the divine flow through us to act in a way that is aligned with the situation for our best good and the best good of all.
Yes, and it's really interesting because as people practice this over time, they get better and better at doing that. Like in the beginning, they say, I can't see the signs. I don't know what I'm being guided to do. I don't trust my intuition. As time goes on and you keep using the prayers and everything else that's in the book, it's a muscle that develops and you start to go, oh, sometimes I'm being shown, nope, it's the situation's not ready yet. You know, it's not time yet. I mean, we could use the example, you and I had trouble getting together for this particular call today. And so to me, you know, my friend said to me, well, doesn't it bother you that it keeps getting postponed? I said, no, there's a perfect time for us to talk. And it wasn't going to happen until it was the right time. And so this goes on in our lives all the time. But if you're not thinking that way, you're thinking, oh, my goodness,
upset.
Why is this happening?
Yes. Yes. And our mind can go into, personally, I go into, maybe I'm not supposed to do this interview. You know, like we question then things when things don't go right. Whereas sometimes it's a question of timing as well. So there is... There is a fine line between sometimes danger and the right timing. And you know what I mean? Like the interpretation could really shift us from one abundant paradigm and not.
Yes. And I think that it's a distinction. You start to feel it in your body. I went through the same thing when we were having trouble finding time. I went inside and I thought, am I supposed to cancel it and just say we're not meant to do it? And I just kept getting, do it.
Yeah.
Just relax and let it happen at the right time. So I think when it starts to show from the inside, and you're right. Sometimes it means, no, this is a terrible idea. Cancel it now. Other times it means just wait.
Yeah. I saw it sometimes in different spiritual practice when there is a huge thing, like crazy thing that just happens before an amazing opening. You know what I mean? Like in some spiritual practice, or when you go and see a therapist and all of a sudden you question if you should go there. But right after that, there is immense light.
Definitely.
How do you explain that? Did you have that? And is that related?
I have that often, that right before there's a tremendous birth, there's the chaos that precedes the birth. And I almost expect it, you know, not that it always has to happen, but I think what you're describing is really common. One thing I want to say is that there's, to me, a misconception that if something like that is happening, something that looks negative, there's an idea, maybe it's in the manifesting world or whatever, that you're doing something wrong and that's why it's happening. Your mind is negative. You've created bad things. It doesn't have to mean that at all. It can mean that it's exactly what you're describing, that all the energy from the past is coming up to be cleared. You might be, there's a word in Sanskrit called samskaras, you know, which is like the old impressions that we're carrying, maybe from past lives, maybe from this life, old wounding. It's all coming up like a storm to get released. And then you land in the new time and you go forward. So it doesn't mean you're necessarily doing anything wrong. It kind of takes the punitive idea out of this.
Yeah. Or we interpret it as negative, but it's not. Like we're arrogant to think that it's negative.
Right. Right.
Last little thing, karma. Some people are locked down with karma, you know, how it's my karma, so it's related to past lives or vows or things from other lives and things that we have done bad, and that now we are not blessed with abundance because of that, or connecting with the divine because we've done some bad things with the divine maybe in other lives, you know, this whole thing. How can we clear that?
Well,
or do we have to?
Yeah, I mean, again, I don't see it so much in that blaming way, I have bad karma and I gotta clear it. I see it more that there are curriculums, there are lessons that a soul wants to learn in a given life. And every soul, it's like a school here, and every soul has a different set of lessons that it wants to learn. So when you welcome those lessons, rather than saying it shouldn't be happening, or, you know, it even changes it. You stop looking at what's going on for somebody else. You stop going, oh, why did that person end up with that amazing trip around the world? Why didn't I have that? You stop caring because you're thinking, I'm busy with my Prarabdha karma. I'm busy with my curriculum. Let me just really open to what the soul wants to learn in the most creative and expansive way. Like, once you start saying yes to that, then what wants to happen can happen. So it, to me, takes out the idea of negative and positive, because, you know, we've all had a million past lives. So, you know, at a certain point, who cares? Now we have the now to open what the lesson is.
Yeah. This conversation seems even more important now these days with everything happening around the world, to navigate and to navigate through life with life in an effortless way, instead of resisting and being in the confusion and the fear of the unknown.
I think it makes it a lot easier, especially in 2020 when COVID first hit, and there was just this sense of everything as we knew it shutting down. And somebody, you know, they'd said to me, how do you navigate this? And I was saying, well, the first thing for me was to say, I'm alive right now in this. So this is what this is. There's something the soul wants to learn from this. And just saying that made it easier, rather than, I didn't sign up for this. Why am I alive in this? Because to me, the general theory is, if we're on the planet and it's happening, there's something the soul can evolve from. And I'm not sugarcoating anything. It's been very, very painful. And even this path isn't one of, you know, you're walking around with a blissful look on your face every minute. It's not that. It's very human. The emotions come up. There's times of fear. There's times of all kinds of things. It's more that it's allowed and then it's offered. And there's spaciousness.
I love this idea of spaciousness.
Yeah, there's room for the universe to do what it wants to do with you specifically. You make that allowance.
Le secret de l'abondance, the secret of abundance. Is it in English as well?
Yes. Oh, I might even. Do I have
English book?
We moved a chair around and I think it's where it is. I don't have it.
I could show it digitally. There we go. It's Not Your Money. Very different title. The Divine Abundance. I love it. Who is it published with in the US?
With Hay House.
Awesome. Oh my God, you went a long way. I'm so proud of you.
Yeah, so...
Well done. I love that. It's Not Your Money. And this is such a great title. So the money we have, this is such a great way to finish this interview. So it's not our money in the end.
In the end, if you think about it, look, if you go out today and it's the last day of being on the planet, what comes with any of us, right? So it just creates a lot of freedom and spaciousness.
Thank you so much, Tosha. The Secret of Abundance in French is now out. Thank you. Thank you very much. Wishing you lots of beautiful things happening in your life, and sending big kisses to all juicy co-creators out there. And if you like this video and it inspired you, it may inspire one of your friends or family around you. So please share it. Thank you so much and see you soon.
Thank you.